طيب، الحمد لله حمدا كثيرا طيبا مباركا فيه، مدح أهل العلم في كتابه العزيز، وقال النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام: من يرد الله به خيرا يفقهه في الدين. أسأل الله يوفقنا لما يحب ويرضاه من القول والعمل، ويجعله خالصا لوجهه الكريم، ويتقبل منا أعمالنا. أما بعد، we stopped in the book of العقيدة الوسطية لشيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية رحمه الله by the explanation of ابن عثيمين at the statement of شيخ الإسلام: وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له إقرارا به وتوحيدا. And I bear witness that there is no God worthy of worship but Allah with no partners. While إقرارا يقر meaning acknowledging so in total oneness. The oneness. توحيد. عليكم السلام ورحمة الله. The Shaykh says أشهد بمعنى أقر بقلبي ناطقا بلساني لأن الشهادة نطق وإخبار عما في القلب. The Shaykh said when you say أشهدُ, and it could be translated as I bear witness or I testify, what is intended by that meaning I acknowledge in my heart and I utter it with my tongue. You acknowledge in the heart, you utter it with the tongue. Because shahada, bearing testimony or testifying, is a statement on that, is a statement on that which is in the heart. It tells us what's in the heart. So if a hypocrite says La ilaha illallah, is that considered a true shahada? No, because the shahada is the heart, the tongue speaking what's in the heart. In the heart there's no La ilaha illallah, but on the tongue there is. We will see what is intended by that as the Shaykh continues. فأنت عند القاضي تشهد بحق فلان على فلان تشهد باللسان المعبر عما في القلب. For example, if you are in a court in front of the judge, you may testify for one person against another person. You testify for one person against another person. So you testify with your tongue what you keep in your heart. واختيرة الشهادة دون الإقرار لأن الشهادة أصلها من شهود الشيء أي حضوره ورؤيته فكأن هذا المخبر عما في قلبه الناطق بلسانه كأنه يشاهد الأمر بعينه. The Shaykh said that the shahada comes from the word we know as mushahada, yushahid, or shuhud, witnesses, and yushahid is to view something with your own eye, with your naked eye. And this is where the word or that meaning is derived from the mushahada. And you say someone seen something, so you call him a shahid or shaheed. And not the shaheed of the battlefield, rather the shaheed of being a witness. He says, so it's as if the person, يعني, what he's saying in his heart is so real, it's as if you could see it. It's as if you can see it. نعم. لا إله إلا الله أي لا معبود حقا أو لا معبود حق إلا الله. وعلى هذا يكون خبر لا محذوفا ولفظ الجلالة بدلا منه. We're not going to get into the grammar, but I want to point something out. You may see sometimes when they want to translate لا إله إلا الله on any kind of you know, whatever things they hang on the wall, they put there is no God but Allah, and that particular translation is incorrect. And if you're able to advise the person, do so. If you can take it down, take it down. Because to translate La ilaha illallah as there's no God but Allah is incorrect. Linguistically, it is correct. But what is intended by it is incorrect. Because the people of Quraysh believed in La ilaha illallah of Rububiyya, the one we learned. Remember we said Rububiyya, the Christians and the Jews and the Muslims, almost everybody agrees, except the atheists, that the one who created the heavens and the earth is God. Where is their problem? Worshipping. Uluhiyya. So La ilaha illallah meaning La ma'bud bihaq, إلا الله. No one truly deserves worship but Allah. Meaning this would say, there's no God worthy of worship but Allah. This is the correct translation. This is the correct translation when you explain it to the people. Otherwise, if they just want to translate it linguistically, then لا إله إلا الله, word by word, is there's no God but Allah. But we know that Allah in the Quran established the presence of other gods. Right? وَلَا تَدْعُ مَعَ اللَّهِ إِلَٰهًا آخَرٍ. Do not call upon besides Allah other gods. Call them Allah إِلَٰهًا. Call them an إِلَه. So, but we said that they're not true. ذلك بأن الله هو الحق وأن ما يدعون من دونه الباطل. Because Allah is the God in truth, the only one deserves the worship, and everybody else, they may call him a God, but in essence they're not. طب ممتاز. وحده لا شريك له. وحده هي من حيث المعنى توكيد للإثبات. لا شريك له توكيد للنفي. وحده alone. And here it is emphasis on affirmation. Emphasis on the affirmation which is إِلَّا اللَّهِ. لَا شَرِيكَ لَهِ is emphasis on the negating which is لَا إِلَهَ. So they become لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. وَحْدَهُ is closer to the last part which is إِلَّا اللَّهِ. لَا شَرِيكَ لَهِ is emphasized in the beginning of it which is لَا إِلَهَ. Because لَا شَرِيكَ لَهِ, no partners with him. إِقْرَارًا بِهِ وَتَوْحِيدًا. إِقْرَارًا هذا مصدر, وَإِنْ شِئِتْ فقول إنه مفعول مطلق لأنه مصدر معنوي. This is advanced grammar that none of us is, at least as far as I know, except maybe the brother and the brother, maybe qualified in terms of this grammar. This is a high caliber grammar, so we will leave it alone, so we will not, it won't do tashwish on us. لقوله أشهد وأهل النحو يقولون إذا كان المصدر بمعنى الفعل دون حروفه فهو مصدر معنوي أو مفعول مطلق, وإذا كان بمعناه وحروفه فهو مصدر لفظي. فقمت قياما مصدر لفظي لفظي, وقمت وقوفا مصدر معنوي, وجلست جلوسا لفظي, وجلست قعودا معنوي, إلى آخر. He's basically breaking it down that مصدر is a word that is derived from a root word, and it could be it could be either verbal or it could be understood, where it is tangible or non-tangible, or something along these lines. Anyways, we will not go there. المهم وقوله توحيدا, meaning believing in it totally. مصدر مؤكد لقوله لا إله إلا الله. توحيدا is emphasizing the whole statement, the testimony of لا إله إلا الله. طيب. وقوله وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم. نقول فيه أشهد ما قلنا في أشهد الأولى. We say this أشهد is the same thing we explained in the first أشهد, لا إله إلا الله. طيب. And who is Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم? هو ابن عبد الله بن عبد المطلب القرشي الهاشمي الذي هو من سلالة إسماعيل ابن إبراهيم أشرف الناس نسبا عليه الصلاة والسلام. He is the son of Abdullah. His father's name was Abdullah. The son of Abdul Muttalib, which is his grandfather. From Quraysh, from Bani Hashim. This is the tribe of the Prophet ﷺ and his lineage. And he is from the loins or the progeny of Ishmael, the son of Abraham. We know who these are. The ones who built the Kaaba, alayhim salatu wasalam. The most honorable of people in terms of lineage is the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم, as it comes in another narration that he mentioned about himself. هذا النبي الكريم هو عبد الله ورسوله. This honorable prophet is the Messenger of Allah, is the servant of Allah and his Messenger. وهو أعبد الناس لله. And he is the most obedient person to Allah. The one, the most worshipping to Allah. وأشهدهم تحقيقا لعبادته. And he is the one who, يعني, the manifestation of the worship is seen through him the most compared to any other prophet or human being. كان عليه الصلاة والسلام يقوم في الليل حتى تتورم قدماه ويقال له كيف تصنع هذا وقد غفر الله لك ما تقدم من ذنبك وما تأخر. He used to get up at night until his feet swell from the duration of standing. And it will be said to him, How do you do that? Why do you do that? And Allah has forgiven your past sins and your future ones. As Allah told them in the beginning of Surah Al-Fatih and in Surah Al-Inshirah. أَلَمْ نَشْرَحْ لَكَ صَدْرَكَ وَوَضَعْنَا عَنْكَ وِزْرَكَ. The wizr is sin. وَضَعْنَا عَنْكَ meaning we removed off you. So he was forgiven عليه الصلاة والسلام for everything he may have done. And we, of course, the sins that may be considered against the Prophet ﷺ are not the sins that one of us might do. It's not like the major sins, and it's the things that are extremely insignificant in comparison to the average Muslim. Anyways, the Prophet ﷺ will respond, فَيَقُولْ أَفَلَا أَكُونُ عَبْدًا شَكُورًا. Shall I not be a thankful servant? يعني, if Allah has forgiven my previous sins and my previous ones and my future ones, it doesn't mean I relax. Rather, if somebody does you a favor, then you must be grateful. So he wanted to be grateful to Allah Azza wa Jal. So he would pray at night. Although he really didn't need to. Because why would we pray at night? Because we want our sins to be forgiven. We want to go to Jannah. He's guaranteed. He could easily just say, okay, you know what? I have a lot of duties to do. I'm a messenger. I got to do da'wah all day and what have you. Let me relax. Go to Jannah anyways. I'm a messenger of Allah. You understand what I'm saying? Realistically, he could be that person. But he was not. عليه الصلاة والسلام. إيه. لأن الله تعالى أثنى على العبد الشكور حين قال عن نوح إنه كان عبدا شكورا. فأراد النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام أن يصل إلى هذه الغاية وأن يعبد الله تعالى حق عبادته. ولهذا كان أتقى الناس وأخشى الناس لله وأشدهم رغبة فيما عند الله. Because Allah عز وجل has praised his servant. He praised the thankful servant. Such as when he said about Nuh, إِنَّهُ كَانَ عَبْدًا شَكُورًا. Verily, he was a thankful servant. Grateful or thankful. And so the Prophet ﷺ wanted to reach that level. He wanted to reach that level. And he wanted to worship Allah the way Allah truly deserves to be worshipped. This is why he was the most pious of people. And among the people he feared Allah the most. And he desired what Allah had for him the most from reward and Jannah. فَهُوَ عَبْدُ اللَّهِ. So he is the servant of Allah. وَمُقْتَدَى عُبُودِيَّتِهِ أَنَّهُ لَا يَمْلِكُ لِنَفْسِهِ وَلَا لِغَيْرِهِ نَفْعًا وَلَا ضَرًّا وَلَيْسَ لَهُ حَقٌّ فِي الرُّبُوبِيَّةِ إِطْلَاقًا. And the essence of his ubudiyyah or servitude to Allah is that he does not possess for himself, neither for others, any benefit or harm. And this is the fine line between Islam and every other religion, really, is given the attributes of rububiyyah to other than Allah. So to Christians, Jesus has all that. And to Hindus, the cow has all that. And to Buddhists, the Buddha has all that. And what have you. The only religion which makes a major distinction between Allah and His creation, no matter how honorable the creation are, is Islam. You're a messenger of Allah, you're the most pious, all the good stuff. Yes, but that's it. You don't benefit or harm. You don't call on to Him. As we received in the email at my house, somebody sent us an email, has an image of the grave of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And they say this image is something that only 0.1 Muslims around the world had the honor to see, the grave of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam from inside. In the Masjid al-Nabawi. And this may lead to shirk. And in Islam we were commanded not to magnify graves. It's a grave where a dead person lies. Period. Now, today, somewhere in the world a Muslim is on the ground doing sujood to someone in the grave. Somewhere in the world a Muslim or a so-called Muslim is throwing a letter to someone who's dead, talking about my son has diabetes and he needs some quick healing. Somewhere in the world some Muslim is worshipping other than Allah and giving what Allah deserves to not only live people, dead people. And they do the same thing. That's why you find in the Masjid al-Nabawi there's hurras around the grave, because some people come and do crazy stuff thinking that they're going to get some barakah from the Prophet ﷺ, and there's no barakah except in following the sunnah. And the sunnah is that he said, Allahumma la taj'al qabri eidan. Oh Allah, do not make my grave a place where it's honored or visited often. Eid is whatever happens every year. ولا وثنا يعبد, and not an idol that is worshipped. And people do just that. They do just that. So anyway.